All right, welcome back, everyone, to the CME Group Short Championship Media Center. I am pleased to be joined by Miss Lydia Ko. Lydia, welcome back to Naples. Just overall, what is it like to be here at the season finale of 2022?
Well, I met Keith Urban today, so that's definitely a start. Learned that he's born in New Zealand, for those that didn't know. But yeah, it's always nice to be here. You know, what Terry Duffy and the whole of CME Group has done to elevate this tournament over the past 9 years, I think. I think because my rookie year was the first time we had that $1 million. And what he's done continuously over the years has been amazing and awesome for our tour and for women's golf. So, yeah, it's a great place to end. You know, it's only a few hour drive from my house as well. So, yeah, excited for a good week. The top 60 players are here. So hopefully we can all showcase some good golf throughout the week.
For you, first off, meeting Keith Urban is also a highlight as well. We just talked to Nelly. Did you see him and go up to him? Did he come up to you?
They were passing by on the golf course, and then you know, I was talking to Terry, and then Keith Urban was right there, and yeah, it was super cool. I said, "Do you play?" And he said, "I play the guitar." So maybe golf is something for him in the future. But I'm not really much of a country, like the music genre person. But he kind of jazzes up country music. And when I saw that we got tickets to be able to like see him tonight, I was super excited and kind of had that fangirling moment. And only as he drove by, I remembered that I maybe should have asked him for a photo. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you might get one tonight. Who knows? As we enter this last tournament of the year, you come in at the top of the Vare Trophy standings, at the top of the Rolex Player of the Year standings, and two wins under your belt from this year. When you look at it overall, all-encompassing, where does this year stack up for you personally?
Yeah, I think this year has been some of the most consistent golf I've played throughout the year. I think when I look at my 9 years on tour, I think I've had seasons where I started the season well, ended the season well, or turned around and in the middle. But I was never like always kind of steadily there from start to the end. And I feel like I've been in that kind of position coming into this week. So it's been a year that I'm very thankful for. And, you know, to have my first win this year in my second event was definitely like an extra bonus, especially because going into the season, I wasn't feeling super confident about my game and wasn't really sure how it was going to go. So yeah, it kind of caught me by surprise, and I was able to take good rhythm from that. And I think really from US Open onwards, I've been playing really consistently. And you know, it's been more than I could have ever asked for. And the win in Korea was like a cherry on top of the cake. So these last couple of weeks, I've been trying to not think too much about, you know, all the awards and the what ifs and what, you know, what could happen, because even though it's been a great year for me and something that I'm very proud of, there's other players that have had phenomenal years as well. And I think this season, more than any other one, there's so many players in contention, and I think it's what makes it super exciting. And, you know, the person that does end up having the lowest score will end up winning the Vare at the end of the week. And then the person that, you know, collectively played really well this season will get the Player of the Year. And I hope that would be me. But, you know, if I don't win it, I don't think I can. I may be disappointed at the time being. But, you know, when I look back at this week, and if somebody said, hey, you're going to win twice, and one of them being in Korea, I would have said, are you sure that's going to happen? So, yeah, I think there's been so many exciting and great things this season so far. So I've got no complaints.
Love that. We'll open it up in the room for questions. We'll start with Beth Ann, and after a few in here, we'll take it to the Zoom as well.
So, Lydia, hypothetically, if you were to win the Player of the Year award, how would you compare how that might feel this time around compared to 2015?
I remember being in this room in 2015 before the event started doing my press conference, and I said, if I could choose anything, and at that time, if you we did it still by to win the globe, like to get the million, not like as part of the prize money. I said if I could choose the million, the player of the year, and maybe the VAR, I would choose the player of the year. Yes, the million is awesome, but I think just to be the best player for that season, those kind of opportunities don't come very often. And for me, a lot of ups and downs, whether in golf and in my personal life, have happened since 2015. So if I was to get it, it would just be really cool to, because it'd be like a summary and all of those moments have added to this moment right now. So yeah, I think it would be more special. I think earlier in my career, not that I did take it for granted, but like things felt like it came easier, you know, like maybe a top 10 or a win. But now, over the last few years, I've gotten to realize, hey, it's not easy, and the level of competition on tour is getting higher and higher. So, you know, your percentage to win is just a little bit more difficult. And I think that's why it would feel special and it'd be like meaningful in a different way. But I remember I wanted it so much then, and my Rolex here has the 2015 Rolex Player of the Year award engraved inside it, so it's like a good reminder for that. And it would just be like special in different ways because I am at a different point in my career to then.
And then just one follow-up to that, how would you compare the strengths of your game now to 2015?
I hope I'm more experienced. Sometimes those experiences may not be great because I've got more in my memory bank to remember, and some are good and some are not so good. Then I think I was a little bit more carefree, just like, how old was I then? 18 or something? Yeah. 18. I was still a teenager, so I think I was just like going around, like just playing golf, and the golf was kind of all I had. And I think then if I had a bad day on the golf course, I didn't feel like a good person. I felt like the golf was reflecting who I was. But now I think I have a better gauge of that and better perspective that, like, this is what I do, and I'm very grateful to be able to do what I love, and, you know, this is what's work for me as well. And it's just like ticking so many of the boxes that I should be grateful for. And, you know, if I don't have as a good day, like, I do get frustrated that I wish it was better, but I don't think like, oh, I shot whatever, like, it just doesn't like take away my self-esteem. Whereas then I think I really correlated both of those, and I don't think it is a healthy position to be in, like for your mental health as well. So in that way, I think I'm able to like get over it. And I think sometimes, you know, some of my lower moments in my career has helped me to be okay about those times. I think when you first hit it, it's so much more difficult because it's like such a new experience, whether it's good or bad experiences. But I feel like I've been able to cover some of it in my experiences. So even if I do hit those kind of times, I hope that it doesn't affect me as much as it did a few years ago.
Thank you.
All right. I just want to quickly start. I know that Matt has been raising his hand on the Zoom for some time as well. Matt, if you'd like to unmute yourself.
Yes. Hello, Lydia. I'm Matt Brown in Auckland, New Zealand. Nice to see you again. Are you aware of the trifecta that you could complete this weekend for New Zealand golf? Stephen Elke won the PGA Champions Tour Order of Merit, you know, last week. Ryan Fox is battling Rory McIlroy on the DP World Tour, and here you are and with a chance in Florida as well. I mean, it would be quite incredible, wouldn't it? And just shows you how the state, I guess, of New Zealand golf at the moment.
Yeah, I actually turned on Golf Channel last week and then saw Stephen Elke are playing. And I didn't get to see the weekend golf because obviously I was playing, but I did see like lots of photos that he was holding their season ending. The Charles Schwab Cup. Yeah, so I thought that was super cool. And obviously he's been around and played it so much longer than I have, but to see like three Kiwis and many other Kiwis on like different tours with like Momoka Kabor getting her wins on the LET access and now getting, I think, her card, full card for LET and like the other tours as well. I think it's very exciting for golf in New Zealand, and hopefully this inspires more juniors to take it up and want to be the next Steve Knacker, want to be the next Ryan Fox or me. So yeah, it's, I think, very exciting. And I did see that, and I saw how well Foxy's been playing. And so he was, I think, second in the standings. So I was like, it would be really cool if it was like three Kiwis up top. You know, we're from far down under, and for us to kind of come on all these different tours and kind of show the New Zealand flag, I think it would be super exciting. But no matter what happens, I think golf in New Zealand has grown, and hopefully this is the start of you know, the Kiwis taking our stance in our respective tours.
Hey, and just one quick follow-up, Lydia. You know, with all that consistency this year, and you're being in line for both the Vare Trophy and the Rolex Player of the Year Award, can you just explain or elaborate a little bit on the decision to part company with Sean as your coach? Because clearly you've achieved some great stuff with him.
Yeah, you know, I sometimes, like, it's not about the person, the two people. Sometimes it's about timing in life. And I've just been all over the map, to be honest. And I was, you know, trying to figure out the logistical things of everything. But I think it was a decision that we both were, obviously not an easy decision, because I respect Sean so much. And he helped me at such a, at a point in my career where I had so many questions in my head that I really wasn't sure where I was heading. And he was able to kind of lift me up. And sometimes our conversations were very non-technique or golf related. And it was just about the mind or breathing or just other stuff outside the golf course. And he helped me so much with that. So it's just, it was more like for this time right now, it just wasn't fit for the situation. But, you know, Sean said, hey, you know, I'm always like a text or call away. You know, we're still, he said we're friends, but for me, like, he's more than a friend. He's like a mentor and somebody that I really look up to. And I know that if I ever need to reach out and like contact him and ask for his advice, he's always going to be there for me. And I think to have somebody like that in your life, not only just in work, is like something that you should be very thankful for, because as all of us know, it's easier to make friends when you're like 5 years old compared to when you're like 25 or like 45, because you just meet so many different people along the way. And to meet somebody that you really connect with, I think, is so much harder as you get older. And Sean is such an incredible person, and I think everybody that really knows Sean knows that he's more than just a golf instructor, and he will always be that kind of person for me.
He did say to me, just finally, Lydia, that he actually was working on getting to the position, and he said it would come soon where you probably wouldn't need him because you were playing so well. And I think he said that's every coach's goal. So, yeah, well done, and all the best this week. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Everybody needs a Sean in their life, though.
I love that, and very beautifully said. We'll go into the room to Steve.
I wanted to follow up a little bit on what Beth Ann said. You said that it was more difficult to win out here now. Can you talk about the difference in the strengths of the field and the tour in general now as opposed to when you won a Player of the Year before?
Yeah, I think like before, it was a little bit more like rare to see like an up and coming like star. Like it might have been like every few seasons or every few year from like this country and this country, but now, like, there are so many good players. I think before you would say, oh, there's only like South Korean players or like American players or like a couple European players that play well, but it's just like all over the map of like so many new up and coming players. I mean, Ataya is obviously a clear example. She's, I think, still 19. is weird. I was the oldest one in the group in Korea when I played the Yeon Hong and Atai, and I'm like, I have you guys by like 6 years and I'm only 25. So it just shows like there are so many like talented players from all over the world, and I think that shows just the level of competition on the LPGA, and also the players have been playing here for like so long for them still to be in contention, like girls that have played like 10 years in tour and getting their first win, like Rhino Tool's win last year at the Scottish Open. So it's just, I think just everybody's improving, and I think because the level of play is getting better and better, like everybody, doesn't matter if you're number one or number 100 or 300 or 1,000, like you're still pushing yourself to like go and see like how good you can get, how you can make the good to even be like great and like great to fantastic. So I think we all push each other and we're all pushing ourselves to be the best version of ourselves. And I think because of that, the level of play is getting like so good that sometimes I'll just play and I'll like go like, wow, like it's just, like it amazes me, and I think that's just how like we're trending in women's golf, and I think that's why there are more and more like junior girls in the girls golf program, you know, taking up the game as well. So I think it's a very exciting time, and you know, it's not like the courses are getting easier, the courses are getting longer, the rules officials have their minds to try and make it as hard as possible for us, and so even then the play is like so good. So it just shows like how much talent there is, and sometimes I wish more people would come out and watch us play to be able to see like how far Nelly hits it, or like how consistent, you know, Jin Young Ko is, how good like Yeon Hong putts. Like I didn't know those things until I played with them, and I was like, oh my god, they're like so good. Like it's just, I wish more people would come out just to see that in life, and then I think they'll be like amazed at like how talented these players are. Maybe I should take like a different marketing position here on tour. Yeah,
I'll certainly hire you if you're looking for something. We'll go to Shizuka.
Hi, I'd like to ask you about your training at gym, because you play so well this year, and then it looks like you gain your muscle. So just wondering mainly, what are you working on at the gym?
It's good that you said gain muscle. I'd be like, it looks like you got big, and I'd be okay.
Yeah.
It's like in Korea, sometimes you go like, you look healthy, and I'm like, thank you. it's just, no, I've been trying to be like more in routine of my workouts. I think probably Tiger Woods years ago set the standard that like working out is part of like your routine and your practices, and now everybody has their own different routines. Some people, I saw Lexi today working out at LA Fitness at 6 a.m. Like, that's not something I would do, but like, it just shows like how important like working out and all those things are for players. To some, it may be lifting heavy weights. Like for me, I like to lift heavier and do more compound weight work when in my off weeks. And then in tournament, try and do like more maintenance, more balance, and see where my body is at, and being more aware of my body. But I think at first it was really hard to do it because I wasn't like used to doing it. But the more I do it, the more I felt like I was, you know, it was able to transfer into my golf game as well. And you know, it's always nice that if you don't have a good day at the office, you know, to go out and sweat it out a little bit, it just makes you feel better. So yeah, I think the working out has become part of my routine. And sometimes I really don't want to go to the gym, but when I push myself to go, and afterwards I feel like so much better. So it is a part that I'm trying to think more of. And I think as like generations go by, I think that is going to be more part of the golf as well. And and sometimes I don't think it's just about weight, but there's just so many things you could do in a workout.
To Beth Ann down in the front here.
One more quick one. I know you've talked over the years about not wanting to play out here too long. 30 was a mark for a long time. How important is it to you to to reach the 27 points for the Hall of Fame before you exit? How much do you think about that?
I don't think I think about it like on a daily basis. I'm not looking and counting down to how many points, but obviously, you know, coming up into this week, I've had people tell me about it. Sometimes I don't want to listen to it, but I think I'm like, see, I clearly don't listen very well. It's like five-ish, seven, whatever, somewhere around there. And as close as it seems, is also, it's really hard. Like when I think about my last three wins in these last couple years, for me winning in Hawaii, I waited, I know some people wait longer, but it was 3 years until pretty much that win. And I just know now that it's just not as easy. And that's why when these opportunities come, yes, I would like to grab it because I know they're not around the corner every single time. So yeah, I would love to for that sake. But I said, even if I had 1 point to go, I don't think I'm gonna continue to push and push another season and another season just so that in the hope of me grabbing it. I don't wanna tire myself out. When I feel like it is the time for me to retire, I will only know at that time, but I don't want to leave the game in regret of I should have stopped then rather than try and like keep going and going and lose passion for golf. And I do it because I love it and I have the drive and motivation to be the best player I can be. And if I can get those accolades, be in the Hall of Fame alongside some of the best and the legendary players, that would be a huge honor. But I don't want that to be my driving factor. I want to play the best golf I can here this week, and whatever happens, like it's gonna happen. So for me, I think that is my mindset and my goal, is that I don't want to get to a point where I no longer want to play because I've tired myself from like trying to grasp it and I've been close and I don't get it anymore. I would rather retire in the thought of, oh, maybe I could have. And then like, it's still like an exciting thought rather than a tiring thought of I should have done this. So yeah, I think that's where my mind's at. Who knows, sometimes I have a long day at the golf course and I'm like, I'm retiring tomorrow. And then some days you have great days and you're like, this is why we play. It's kind of like, you know, when you're playing the Pro-Am, that one shot, it gets us like coming back. And I want to, even until the day I stop playing, I want to have that passion and I don't want to lose that. And I think it's sometimes really hard to have that when you're doing something for like a long period of time. But I want, like my role model is kind of like Lorena, where she was at her best. And I'm sure if she continued playing, she would have like dominated. And I'm like, thank goodness she wasn't playing like when I came on tour. But it's like, I want to retire like that and retire while still playing good golf.
I think I'm going to wrap it up with a question here from the Zoom, which kind of touches on what you were just talking about. But what have the past 2 years really revealed to you about sustaining your careers into your 20s, as you are still in your 20s? And then I'll have a follow-up to that before we wrap.
Yeah, I think I was very fortunate enough to come out and play on tour as a 16-year-old turning 17. And in ways I still can't believe that when my next birthday I'm only turning 26. But you know, when you play during the season, it goes by so quick. And then I realize now that it's my 9th year on tour already and I can't believe it. Like I feel like I was wearing those big glasses as on my rookie year not too long ago. Yeah. So it's like the saying of like when you're having fun, it goes by fast, but also just like life on tour just makes it go by fast as well. And I think sometimes when you're not playing as well and you have those lower moments, I think those times feel so long. Like those, my 3 years from Mediheal win to the Lotte win, it felt longer than that period of time. But just, I think all those times build you up to the player you are now. And I think if I didn't have those times, I probably wouldn't have some of the mindset I do now. And I think I would be more fazed by every little thing. And I said, when you're on tour, like after a while, there's that line where your give a S level goes down and down and down. And I think in ways it's not like a bad idea. It's not a bad thing. And you're just able to play freely. And that's like my goal, is to play without fear. And like, I'm out there just being free. And, you know, that's what I want to continue to do. And sometimes it is easier said than done, but that's why we all have goals that we keep trying to reach to.
And a follow-up is, what would your advice be to your younger up-and-coming players navigating careers that are also younger and getting into your age as well?
Yeah, I think just because somebody did this at this age, I think it's really hard to compare one player to another. Everybody has their own path. Some people turn professional early. Some people play collegiate golf. Some people come from the Epson Tour. Like, everybody has their own route. So I think when you start comparing yourself to other people, then it's like nonstop. I have done it before, I'll be honest. I've compared myself to other people, and then when I went down that road, I realized I was only thinking about the negatives and what I need to do. And yes, you need that kind of perspective to know what you want to work on, but at the same time, you got to know what are your strengths, and that way you're able to like keep growing on that and have the confidence in that even when things don't go so well. So I think just trust your journey, and most of the time just stay true to your emotions and your feelings. And I think when you are very honest with yourself and transparent with yourself, you're able to get a better idea and do what's best for you, because what's best for me is not the right answer for somebody else.
We could listen to you talk all day, but we'll let you go. Thank you so much for joining us, Lydia.
Thank you.